too many manuscripts this morning, so. Jesus said, "Come to me, all you who are weary and carrying heavy burdens, and I will give you rest." Today we come together to share the burden of grief that we feel and to lay our sorrow at the feet of Jesus, to seek his consolation and his peace. We come to mark, remember, and celebrate the life of Peter John McLaughlin, beloved son, brother, father, uncle, husband, life partner, friend, and brother in Christ. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. God has given us many promises in Scripture. Jesus said, "Do not be afraid. I am the first and the last. I am the living one. I was dead, and now look, I'm alive forever and ever. I am the resurrection and the life. The one who believes in me will live, even though he dies. And whoever lives by believing in me will never die." And the Apostle Paul wrote to us, "I am convinced that neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither the present nor the future, nor any powers, neither height nor depth, nor anything else in all of creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus." These are God's promises that he has fulfilled to Peter, and he makes them to you today. Let us be in prayer. Heavenly Father, our hearts are grieving, for one whom we loved is gone from among us. Great Comforter, cover us with your grace and mercy, and surround us with your peace in this hour and in the days to come. We thank you that you alone are our refuge, our strong tower, our defender, and our peace. We thank you that no matter what we face, you are still on the throne, you are still in control, and that no evil can ever stand against you. For you alone have won the final victory. You have defeated the last enemy, death, once and for all, for those who love you. Peter knew you and loved you, and now lives and reigns with you forever. We thank you, Father, that you are with us. We thank you that you love us. We thank you that your presence is close and that you weep with those who weep. Thank you for your promise that your power and love will never fail and that you have now fulfilled your promise to Peter. In the name that is above all names, Jesus Christ our Savior. Amen. Amen. This morning there is a couple of hymns that were particular favorites of the family. The first is "Be Thou My Vision." If you look in your bulletin, you're going to find a handout that has the words on it. And it is our custom to stand when we sing, so if you're able, please stand.
Thank you.
reflection shared from family members. And first, I would like to call Patrick up to the pulpit to share his reflections of his dad.
How you guys doing today? Good. Okay. So, dear Dad, dear Dad, I said, Dad, he would reply, "That's me." "I hear you," but he wouldn't acknowledge you until you asked him three times. Okay. "Yes, Dad, Dad, this is Mr. Find It," because Dad would often lose things, and he would ask me to find it, so I got that title as a young kid. "You are an outstanding father. You had a way of doing things in life that some people may not do, but he would get it done, one way or another. He would help anybody. Especially us kids, and anybody that he came across. My father loved losing things, or misplacing things. My brother and I would help him find things from time to time. My brother and I would help, we all had great times with Dad, learning stuff, exploring stuff, going kayaking, biking, hiking, all the above. Trips to Epsom with my grandfather, George McLaughlin. Now, I know that was my dad's role model, as all fathers are role models to us sons. Things that Dad loved, like I said, biking, hiking, kayaking, fishing, boating, nature walks, and camping, were all part of him teaching us to be adventurous. I recall, I know that Dad had fun up in Dixmont, Maine, a few weeks ago, and trips to New Jersey that I didn't think that he could handle, but he did it because he wanted to. He wanted to be a part of my life outside of what he would know, and you know, he tagged along, and that was a great experience, and I'm glad that I had that time with him. He was very heavily involved in the home audio business, PM Systems. He helped out a lot of people with their computer problems and speakers and all that. And I would be stuffed in the back of the van in between speakers and TVs, along with Tim and Colin. They would go as well, and that was always an adventure. At the end of the day, Dad taught us a lot, and at times we take things for granted, but you realize it growing up. So I'm gonna conclude this with I love you, Dad. You're my hero, and rock on, you know? Thank you.
Thank you, Patrick.
Thanks.
It's never easy to get up here.
Yeah.
And I'd like to call Colin up to also share some memories of his dad.
Thank you.
Testing 1, 2, 3, PM systems, mic check. Testing 1, 2, 3, PM systems. My name is Colin McLaughlin, Peter's third son. My father gave my brothers many experiences growing up, but that was, may not have been the most orthodox way as a parent, but that was him. In order to get his attention, we couldn't call him dad. It had to be Peter, Pete, or some people called him Paddling Pete. My father loved music and all the trivia that goes along with it. His obsession would drive us nuts growing up. He had an elaborate love of music. As mother coined it, hokey pokey music. As well as rock and folk music. The love of rock and folk music, which is some appreciated by Tim and myself, including those by Pink Floyd, Eric Clapton, Bob Dylan, and Cat Stevens. He even had an entire collection, which I happily went through them. As I had to sort through the ones I enjoyed and the ones I didn't like because they were just hooker, just plain weird. I'd get into someone else. I remember all the times we were heading to family trips, either Higgins or McLaughlin side. My father would choose the radio, something he liked. He always asked my mother and I, who's this? We sometimes had no idea who it was, but Tim and I enjoyed the game. Most of the time in music, we always played along. He always had some piece of trivia to share about the artist or the song. This trivia would always drive my mother nuts, because she barely knew what the heck was going on in the car. The past few years, our relationship has been a roller coaster. As we had our differences, but we finally were able to rekindle upon the connection. Upon my engagement and marriage to my wife, Kellyn, my father and I were able to work together in celebrating the joy of two combined families. I was happy to have him walk down the aisle in actual suit and tie. Since he never liked to dress up, glad to have Santa by his side. Sharing passionate love and appreciation for technology, we're able to share the ideas on how we would handle situations. I could ask him, "Hey Dad, what job are you working on?" I know it brought joy and tears to know that he was interested in the same field of work as him. It proud to him that I served in the military for it, even though he wasn't able to truly show it. The life lesson I learned from my dad was not realized until I became an adult. Setting your priorities in your life on what was important, finish those goals fully through, is the most important. While connecting recently, thinking about my dad, he realized that even though his way of connecting was not always with me, was always traditional, he loved me and always be a part of me. I can picture how he plans his day. Coffee shop, slurping on black coffee, checking emails, sports activity, hiking, biking, or kayaking in the heaven clouds, doing audio video job for the angels, let's just hope he doesn't space it on too much, checking emails again, end of day with a red wine, spin glass for the smelling, the first pour, taking a sip. Love you, Dad.
Thank you, Colin. And I'd like to call Lori Armstrong up, who's going to share some memories of her big brother.
Hello, everyone. Hello. My name is Lori, and I'm Peter's middle sister of three. I don't think I ever was his favorite, but today I'm going to say that I'm his favorite, because he, of course, is my favorite brother. I want to thank everyone for coming today. It means so much for our family, how people are honoring him and celebrating his life today. He was rich in family, friends, and love, which is evident today. From his friends from Kiskadee, to his stereo clients, for those he hiked with or kayaked with, all new and old, Everyone here seems to have a story about how my brother has impacted their lives. Most of you are here today know Peter in his adult life. I think we all agree that he was a true gentleman and caring soul. I'm going to touch a few things about Peter growing up back in the day. Peter was the firstborn to George and Nancy McLaughlin back in 1955. Julie, myself, and Jean followed over the next 6 years. My mom always told us that Peter was so good and perfect that she wanted three more just like him. Too bad we were all girls. We grew up in Hanson and had what was a typical childhood. We got along, but then we didn't, if you know what I mean. Peter sort of stuck to himself being the only boy, but he picked on us, and for no reason, of course. He used to deliver Indian sunburns. I'm not sure if everyone knows what that is, but ask your parent. And he'd deliver them, and the victim, well, it depends on who was his least favorite that day. And he wouldn't stop until you shed real tears or had us yelling, "I take it back," for whatever he thought we did to instigate his wrath. Somewhere between the age of 8 and 10, Peter asked for a toy cannon for Christmas. Well, Santa brought him one. And unbeknownst to his parents, he would make his sisters stand at the bottom of the stairs so he could shoot us with plastic cannonballs, which were the size of a giant meatball. And they hurt. And his bedroom was just at the top of the stairs, and our sisters' rooms were at the end of the hallway. So each of us had to walk gingerly past his bedroom door, because you never knew if he was secretly planning an attack. He antagonized babysitters. One instance was when Phyllis Robichaux babysat one evening. She and my sister sat in the living room watching the Brady Bunch, and Peter comes walking down the stairs with a lit cigar in his mouth. I mean, he was like 10 or 11. But the cigar was actually a rolled up paper bag that he lit, and it was just burning out of control. He was smoking it. I think he also locked the babysitter in the cellar. I know, you never thought he'd be like this, right? So, as he got older but still a teen, he somewhat matured and became involved with Boy Scouts. With each badge he strived for, he jumped in with both feet. When he was working toward his survival badge and preparing for a worldwide catastrophic event, he fully prepared both his own home and the neighborhood kids for the upcoming disaster. He stockpiled food rations, emergency equipment, bedding supplies, cots with blankets, and a fully packed backpack to help those in need. It didn't stop there. He held safety drills with the neighborhood friends at his house and made us all participate. We practiced evacuating the house, practiced using bandages and gauze, tourniquets, which really hurt, and lifting injured parties using backboards. In all seriousness, Peter was passionate about scouting and met all the requirements for earning his Eagle Scout badge. He spent summers at Camp Squanto in leadership roles, and there he met a lifelong friend, Patrick Kitamira, who lives in Japan, who the family is still in touch with. Patrick has come over to the U.S. a lot of times and visited with our family. So Peter went off to UMass, and this isn't too long, sorry. He went off to UMass Amherst, and after 4 years returned home with a new love, beer. He set up shop in the basement with hundreds of dollars of beer-making supplies. The house reeked of yeast, rotten eggs, fermentation, and not a soul that I knew liked his finished product. His other love was stereos and sound systems. With his own stereo, the louder the better. Moving to Plymouth, he started his business, Sonic Seasonings, selling stereo equipment and installations. Mm-hmm. This eventually became PM Systems. In the mid-80s, Peter married and had his three boys, Timothy, Patrick, Colin, and made Plymouth his home. He established his business and became well known in the community and was a go-to man for sound systems. In between jobs, Peter's interests included kayaking, biking, hiking, and photography. He became known as Paddling Pete to his friends and enjoyed his time outside in nature. He was a quiet man. He could be in a room and say nothing, or he could be in a room and dominate a conversation. That was Peter. Those who knew him understood him. Once a friend, always a friend. Whether it be from school days or just a few years back, when you became Peter's friend, you were in it for the long run. Peter was lucky to have found his girlfriend, Sandy Birdsall. They shared similar interests and the love of the outdoors. We as family will be forever indebted to Sandy for her kindness, her compassion, and love. She was always by his side during his illness. Fulfilling Peter's adult life was his embracement with the Chiltonville Congregational Church in Plymouth. The church's outpouring of love and support and faith keep Peter strong. We are ever so grateful. I'd like to end this with a text message that Julie, Jean, and myself would frequently receive from Peter right up until his last days. Today is a gift from God. Enjoy it. And it always had a big thumbs up emoji. Peter left a big impact on so many lives. He will be missed dearly. I love you, Peter. And just to quote, I will love you until the moment I pass from this existence to the next. And then I will find you again and love you so much.
Thank you, Lori. That was beautiful and very humorous, and I think you really captured Peter. Sandy, you're not in here, but I know Sandy wants to come up and say a few words. Sorry. Hi, everybody. I'm not in the bulletin because we weren't sure if I was going to be able to do this, and I still might not be. So, but we're going to give it a go. I may repeat some things that people said, and some people are going to say, but just know that the Holy Spirit. 1 Peter 4:8-9. Above all, love each other deeply, because love covers a multitude of sins. Offer hospitality at one another without grumbling. I'd like to thank everyone for coming today to honor the life of Peter. And I'd like to especially thank all those who have worked to make today a special day of remembrance and celebration for all of us. I also want to thank everyone who has extended themselves over the last 2.5 years to make this journey with Peter one of affirmation, joy, and love, despite the challenges he faced every day. Although he could be a man of few words, he would always comment how much he enjoyed the fellowship of his friends and families after a visit. He was also a man, as you've already discovered, of many passions. A new gadget would occupy his attention for many days with YouTube visits, Google searches, Amazon and Best Buy investigations, as well as emails and texts to family and friends to share his great find. A planned trip to Epsom, Maine, New Hampshire, to his usual destinations to see the Boys of Shin Pond or the Camp at Bear Springs, or a visit to my sister's, or with birthday and holiday celebrations with family, would fill him with happy anticipation of a great gathering, fun story, an adventurous hike, and or excellent food. Missions was also a passion that extended from his personal agenda and outward through church and beyond. His personal missions were doing dump runs for church, friends, and myself, along with work, support, and patience for those in need, offering that for those in need. He was also committed to the Salvation Operation Christmas Child, in which his enthusiasm ignited that of his Aunt Carol, who in turn pulled her church family into participating and being responsible for nearly 1/3 of collected boxes this year. He was also devoted to Heifer International, Christmas Doves, and Pastor Bliss's trips to Bon Bon, Haiti to build a Christian church in a hostile environment. In fact, he got a gift card recently, and he made sure that I was going to donate it for the next trip. He was always thinking ahead. He, even this last few weeks, we had to get special sheets for his bed from hospice, and I couldn't find them anywhere, and I was a little surprised they didn't supply them. He went, "Do I need to go on Amazon?" I said, "Sure." So he went on Amazon, he found a great deal with four sets, and he said, "Okay, we only need two sets. I want you to give the other two sets to hospice so that the next person doesn't have to go through this." And they've been delivered. He was also a supporter of WGBH, WUMB, and WMVY, public radio stations. He enjoyed being current on music offerings locally and liked finding new favorites, as well as visiting familiar and reliable standards. For many years, Thursday nights at the New World Tavern, listening to Mark T. Small was a staple weekly activity. Prior to that, it was the Irish Sessions. Another staple activity was daily visits to Kiskadee, becoming more than a regular at the local coffee shop. He was an expected fixture in his favorite seat. Peter was also always on the hunt for what he called Sandy-friendly restaurants due to my dietary restrictions. He was always at the ready to explore a new venue. His love of food included a quest for the perfect lobster roll, which wasn't just about flavor. It also was about amount, it was about texture, and it was about presentation. And then he would send his photos of his latest meals and finds, sending links of the most intriguing recipes he found for loved ones to try. Another passion he enjoyed was finding off-label use for things. Let me explain what off-label use is. In the medical field, there are medications created for specific use, and if that happens to have a secondary use, so if you have a medication for seizures, but then it's good for depression and anxiety, the off-label use would be for the depression and anxiety because it was specifically developed for seizures. So he liked finding the off-label use for things. So I have some props to explain this. These might look like ordinary glasses to everyone, and these are his glasses, but to him, they were a dog toy. What he would do is he would get the light just right in the kitchen, and then he would create little spots of light on the floor for my dog to chase. And he would just get such glee out of the dog pouncing and jumping and scratching my cabinets. And he would just do it, and I would say, "You've got to stop getting the dog worked up." And we just keep doing it. So, to him, off-label use of glasses would be dog toy. Let's see. Okay.
Next prop.
This looks like a spatula. But in Peter's world, this is an excellent kitty litter box scraper.
Oh my Lord.
And not only just a regular from the dollar store spatula, it was my grandmother's antique spatula. And he thought bleaching it and putting it back in the drawer was a good idea. I put a mix to that. I said, so I had to watch what he used. So even a few weeks ago, he was informed that anything that's in the kitchen stays in the kitchen. If it's a use for the kitchen, it does not get removed. But Peter, being Peter, didn't really listen. So this might look like a cat food can lid. To him, it was the perfect stopper for the bathtub. So this will not be used with food either. So the list goes on. Those are just a few examples. And I could go on and on. But the last few days have been really busy with love and support of so many people. There was little downtime to write what I had hoped to write. And I swear I heard Peter telling me not to worry. Be with everyone. That's what I would want. So I did. So, to make it easier to write this, I thought I'd make a list. I'd list the things I would miss about Peter, and tell things that, and then a list of things that I wouldn't miss about Peter. The things I will miss: his wry smile, his kind heart, holding hands and hugs, his unexpected thoughtfulness, praying together at night at mealtime with Shirley, no matter where we were, his genuine love for his family and friends, his playfulness, his joy to support Heifer International, Christmas Child, and Christmas Doves, as well as others, his love of food, his adventurous spirit, his enthusiasm for new recipes, his quiet pursuit of pleasure to share, his love of music, walking the dogs and exploring trails, his devotion to his loved ones, his good humor, his good nature, his support of my chocolate habit, his use of code words that challenge the rest of us to decipher, his patience, his fortitude, his cooking, his pleasant willingness to help when asked to do anything. This list is far from complete, but to move on, I will list some of the things I won't miss about Peter. Of course, I won't miss the doctor appointments, witnessing his decline, and the feeling of helplessness. I can't read this next word. This is kind of small, so you might not know what it is, but it's a hospital ID bracelet. He asked me to save this one. I usually take them and shred them. You get crazy about me shredding everything, but I don't want to be going in my garbage. Except him, of course. This one's different. After getting home the last time from the hospital, he called me from the other room. "Hun, do you know where my ID bracelet is?" I answered yes, as I was looking at it right then. He said, "I'd like you to save that one." I asked why. He said, "Well, I'm pretty sure it's my last one. I don't think I'll be going to the hospital again." Well, Peter, right you are. It was your last one. No more hospitals, no more pain, no more weighing yourself or trying to hide from me how sick you were. You are home. You are where I will see you soon enough. Let me end with two verses I think appropriate. John 14:2. "My Father has many rooms. If that were not so, would I have told you that I am going to prepare a place for you?" And on a last note, an epitaph perhaps, Luke 14:12-14. "Then Jesus said to his host, 'When you give a luncheon or a dinner, do not invite your friends or your brothers or sisters, your relatives or rich neighbors. If you do, they may invite you back, and so you'll be repaid. But when you give a banquet, invite the poor, the crippled, the lame, the blind, and you will be blessed. Although they cannot repay you, you will be repaid at the resurrection of your neighbors," or the righteous, sorry. May God place a blessing on his word, his people, and of course to you, dear Peter. 1:4:3. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you, Sandy. And Kellyn, Peter's daughter-in-law, is going to share with us. Go in peace.
No more night, no more.
Kellyn. That was beautiful. Well, the 23rd Psalm is an enduring message of God's love and the depth of it to us. And I would like us to read this in unison. It's printed in your bulletin. For those who haven't memorized it, I know when I was in Sunday school, we had to memorize the 23rd Psalm. So anybody with white hair probably knows it. But let us join together in reading it. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil, and my cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Amen. This time I'd like to ask Tim to come up, and he's going to share the reading from John 14, verses 1 through 6.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Do not let your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many dwelling places. If it were not so, I would have told you. For I go to prepare a place for you. If I go to prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you to myself. That where I am, there you may be also. And you know the way where I'm going. Thomas said to him, Lord, we do not know where you are going. How do we know the way? Jesus said to him, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father but through me.
Thank you, Tim.
Thank you.
And this reading from Revelation 21, verses 1 through 4, gives us the picture of heaven. Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away. I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down from heaven from God. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, Look, God's dwelling place is now among the people. And he will dwell with them. They will be his people, and God himself will be with them and be their God. He will wipe every tear from their eyes. There will be no more death, or mourning, or crying, or pain, for the old order of things has passed away. The word of the Lord. How can we capture in a few words, in an hour, anything truly meaningful about a life? And yet this is what draws us all together here today. A life that has not only come and gone, but has in some way inextricably shaped and changed our lives for the better. As his pastor, I knew Peter for the past few years of his life. And to me, Peter was the personification of the gentle man, in the fullest sense of that term. One who was intentionally considerate of others and steadfastly loving of those closest to him, to his family and his friends, and often even to strangers. And our memories capture the picture of Peter that lives on in our hearts. I had the privilege of meeting with some of his family members on Saturday, and we talked about this. His sister Julie described him as once a friend, always a friend. And Laurie said that too. Brother-in-law Art remembers Peter's arranging work weekends at the camp in New Hampshire with Jim and Mike and George, and Peter good-naturedly somehow always managing to get out of the work. Son Tim has a vivid memory of helping Peter to install a sound system at the Marshfield Fair with the highlight being the photo op with Candyman Wrestler. Still have that photo?
Somewhere.
Okay, I'd like to see that. Son Patrick coined the phrase Peter time as he learned to work alongside his dad at Peter's pace, slow, meticulous, and character building for a young boy, right? And his son Colin, even just 3 days before his death, accompanied Peter on his last service call. His daughter-in-law Kellyn has fond memories of Peter's great gift of storytelling. Shirley, his friend, said she'll never forget his laughter, and Sandy, his kindness and his contagious smile. And you know, in a little while, we're gonna move all these chairs, we're gonna put tables up, and you're all gonna have the opportunity to share your cherished memories of Peter with one another and reflect on how he changed your life for the better. You know, in the end, it's not how well you lived your life that counts. It's how well you loved in your life. And your testament to Peter today proves that he not only loved well, but he was well loved. But Peter's kindness and humor and generous spirit were the outworkings of love in his heart. And the Bible tells us where love comes from. It comes from God, because God is love. And you know, God loved Peter. He loved him into a loving family, right here, his mom, Nancy, right in the front row here, his sisters, his brothers-in-law, his boys, his nieces, his nephews. All of the folks who loved him, Sandy and Mara. God loved Peter into his family, first at St. Joseph's Parish in Hanson when he was a kid, and then in St. Peter's up in North Plymouth, and for the past 10 years here among the body of Christ at Chiltonville Church. And I can't fully express how loved Peter was here, and you can just imagine, because you loved him in the same way. God showed Peter how to love his son, Jesus, and how Jesus would have Peter love others. And this love was expressed in the true seeking of a deep relationship with other people. He really wanted to know you. Those whom he knew for a lifetime, and those whom he continued to meet. And the mark of his outward concern for others was the family expectation, I'm told, that whatever the holiday gathering, Peter would bring along someone as a guest. Sometimes somebody he had just met. Yeah. So it was always like, who's Uncle Peter bringing this time? But you know, he wanted to share that joy and love of these festive times with a loving family, with someone who didn't have one. And Jesus also showed Peter how to love this wider community and those whom he would never even meet. He was a generous donor of his time and substance as a Boy Scout leader. We know he was an Eagle Scout because Lori told us, but he was a Scout leader. He was a member of the Ancient Order of Hibernians, a friend of the Miles Standish State Forest. He had the heart of a missionary, with his special loves being the Heifer Project, and we heard about the shoebox ministry that he did with Aunt Carol, and the First Congregational Church of Bonbon, Haiti, the only congregational church in Haiti, by the way, that's being planted by our sister churches. He caught a vision and a passion for that, as well as his heart for here at Chiltonville. Jesus also showed Peter how to love and care for creation. He had a passion for recycling. We've heard about that. That was a great ministry that he had here at the church. And he loved the outdoors. And we heard about the kayaking, but the hiking, the fishing, the biking, the camping, photography, birding, travel, and geocaching, which I just learned about. Apparently that's, you know, you're out on a hike and somebody leaves some kind of a trophy and then you're supposed to leave something out. I don't know. You know how it goes. I don't. You know, it's not in my wheelhouse, let's put it that way. But you know, he was always curious. He had a love for God's word. And faithfully, every Sunday, he would sit where you're sitting, Lori, with that video camera. And he would, you know, God will have to forgive him for this. He would tape my sermons. But they would go out on YouTube. I don't know who watches them, but some people watch them. Okay, sometimes some people watch them. You never know what, you know, the word of God is going to go out across the world. So he had many ministries that he did quietly and diligently, and he worked behind the scenes. And he was somebody who noticed things. He would just do things because he would notice they would need to be done. Peter was truly a lovely man. He was filled with the joy of love that he was eager to share with others. But you know, his love and joy were deeply embedded in his soul. He was deeply tested because he was diagnosed with pancreatic cancer, which is incurable. We know that. Do you know the median survival rate is 3 to 6 months after diagnosis? Only 20% of those patients survive the 1 year mark. And yet Peter lived for going on 3 years. And I say lived. I mean, a lot of people say, oh, I'm battling cancer. Not Peter. Peter was one of the most strong-willed, in the best sense of that term, people that I've ever met. Because he was determined that he was not going to allow cancer to define his life, the way that he lived, his being. As a matter of fact, with his missionary heart, he determined to seek the good out of a bad situation. He courageously, I would say, worked with Dana-Farber for all that time to test out new treatments. I don't know how many he had, how many standards, maybe 3 or 4? New treatments that, you know, we hoped that would prolong his life and give him better quality, and some of them did. But, you know, some of them were awful. And I think he did that to benefit others, that what he did was going to change the lives of people in the future. But, you know, Peter didn't rely on self-will and medicine alone. He called upon the great physician in prayer and allowed this body of Christ, Chiltonville Church, to come alongside him, to uphold him in prayer since his diagnosis. You know, God does miracles through prayer, too. And I think that had a lot to do with his longevity. And Peter, and I was saying to the family, as a pastor and a hospice chaplain, I've done hundreds of funerals. This is a tough one for me. I loved this man. I really did. And you know, Peter was a Christ bearer here for us. As he modeled the grace of Christ's suffering love in his final 3 years. But you know, he wasn't doing it alone. Because Jesus was right there with Peter, suffering with him and for him. Now I hear this often at times of loss as a pastor. And so often when tragedy strikes, we hear this phrase, God never gives us more than we can handle. Well, you know something, it's not true. And it's not comforting. So if you're at a funeral, don't ever say that to anybody, please. It's not comforting, because that's not what God promised us. If you take another look at that 23rd Psalm that I just made you say with me, okay, you'll see what I mean. Because one of the reasons that this psalm is a part of most every Christian funeral is because it tells us just the opposite. It's not that God never gives us more than we can handle. It's that God gives us whatever we need to handle whatever life gives us. And so when tragedy happens in life, God doesn't just leave us to our own wits and wills to just get on with it. No, God walks alongside us. He guides us and he provides us whatever we need to face our trials. That's what the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want, means. And God is able to support us in our confusion and our despair and our grief. God is right here with you this morning. That's the promise of green pastures and still waters. Even in the midst of the deepest and darkest trials of our lives, God is here to give us that peace that passes our human understanding. That's how he restores your soul. God is present with us through his Holy Spirit. His Holy Spirit is right here in this room. He's in us. We don't have to become hostages to life's circumstances and the things we don't understand. Because God gives us rest. And he shows us the way out of our sorrow and our grief. He even wrestles with our pain at the deepest levels, the despair and the disorientation that we can't even put into words at times of deep loss. God hears it clearly because the Holy Spirit brings to his ears even the groans from our hearts. And even though we walk through the valley of the shadow of death in despair, we're not alone and we have nothing to fear because Jesus is there. And he's been there for us. He's already gone through it for us. No evil can touch us because Jesus already conquered evil on the cross. And so the promise that God makes to us is not that we're going to be exempt from bad things happening in our lives. How many of you have never had anything bad happen in your life? I see a lot of hands going up there. It's not that we're not going to suffer or experience grief or loss or despair. The promise is that God will go through it with us, has already gone through it for us, and that there is life continuing, both on earth and in eternity in our Father's house in heaven. Sandy said that. Tim said that. There is many rooms in our Father's house. And so that's the promise that God made to Peter. And I'm sure that Peter was resting in this promise in his last days and even the years before that. And that's the promise I want you to grab hold of today. In a world that's increasingly characterized by the bad, can I get an amen on that? God promises us his goodness and mercy, his grace, will not only be with us, but will follow us wherever we go. And his grace and mercy and goodness in our lives will also impact the lives of everyone around us. And wasn't that the promise fulfilled for you in the life of Peter John McLaughlin? Today, we know grief and despair in ways that we've probably never imagined. But I tell you, it's good to grieve. Because that's how God made us. We grieve because we love, and one whom we love has gone from our presence, and we feel it. But you know, now Peter knows love in ways that he never imagined. He's in a place of total love, a place of goodness beyond our fondest dreams, and he has a new life, a never-ending life in a place that God has made especially for him in God's own home. And it's there that you will find Peter when it is your time to be called to your true home. May our God and Father give you the assurance in your hearts today that Peter is well and joyful and waiting for that day. And in the time in between, trust Jesus to carry you through your deepest hours of need with the same everlasting arms that now hold Peter and you closely to his heart. Let us pray. Loving Jesus, at such a time as this, you comfort us with this assurance. Do not let your hearts be troubled. In my Father's house there are many rooms, and I go to prepare a place for you. And I will come back, and I will bring you to be where I am. We take comfort in knowing that Peter is in that special place you have prepared just for him, that he now lives in eternity with you, released from his pain and frailty, and surrounded by your love. Dear Lord, help us to grieve as we must, but never to lose hope. For just as you died and rose again in victory, we take heart in knowing that you promised the same for Peter, and that you have fulfilled your promise. We praise you that in you is the power that overcomes the world, through which we have newness of life and strength in Jesus Christ our Lord, who taught us to pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. And let us stand and sing the wonderful hymn, Amazing Grace. There's only four verses we're going to sing. It's on the bulletin insert.
Amazing grace.
bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you his peace. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost. Amen.